We have incoming Tourism Secretary and Vice President Sara Duterte Carpio spokesperson, Lilawan Mayor Cristina Frasco. I would have to say, Mayor Frasco, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. Mayong buntag.
All right, and congratulations on your new post. I wanted to ask you first, before we talk about tourism, have you already spoken with outgoing Tourism Secretary Berna Puyat?
My team has sent a formal letter communication requesting a coordination for purposes of transition.
Okay, and when it comes to Liloan, I'm sure you are fixing what needs to be done before you actually leave Liloan. What can we expect there?
We can expect a continuity of all of the programs and projects that we have started for Liloan, considering that the vice mayor elect that will be succeeding me in the position of mayor is also a member of our party, and I've already worked very closely with him as he's been our first counselor.
Oh, and then the vice mayor will be the number one counselor, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And that's also a party mate.
Yes, that is correct. In the last elections, we were blessed with the mandate given by the people of Liloan, overwhelmingly, who voted for the straight ticket from the mayor, vice mayor, entire council.
All right. Now, Mayor Cristina, let's go back. Take us behind the scenes. How did you get this post?
I didn't apply for this post, but I received a call from President-elect Bongbong Marcos offering to me the position to lead the Department of Tourism, seeing as how the President-elect views tourism as one of the pillars of the economy that can help our country as it recovers from the pandemic and from various calamities.
Okay, and what made you decide to actually take the post? I mean, clearly you have another term as Liloan mayor, and you've done quite a lot in Liloan. I mean, I've read the executive summary of everything you've done to change Liloan. Why would you want to become tourism secretary? What made you say yes?
Well, first, as I expressed to President-elect Bongbong Marcos, I consulted with my family, namely my husband, Congressman Duke Frasco, my mother, Governor Gwen Garcia, and as well as Vice President-elect Sara Duterte and our local leaders, barangay captains and constituents in Liloan that gave me a fresh term. And from my consultations and discussions with them, everyone is in agreement that the honor of leading the Department of Tourism is one that cannot be turned down, considering that it will allow me to have a bigger platform to help more people in our country, especially considering that the tourism is one of the most gravely affected industries post-pandemic. Duty to country is paramount, and this opportunity to help people in a larger capacity is one that I accept wholeheartedly.
Yeah.
Now, it's also a great honor for Cebu, with a Cebuana now being offered to lead the Department of Tourism. And it is an affirmation of all of the inroads and the accomplishments that Cebu has done, notwithstanding the difficulties of the pandemic as far as the tourism industry is concerned.
Meron po bang hiningi si President-elect Marcos sa inyo nung nag-usap kayo sa telepono for the post?
He didn't ask for anything other than my commitment to help his administration help the gravely affected workers of the tourism industry, as well as the negatively impacted tourism stakeholders. And so it is this earnest desire to effect meaningful programs for the tourism industry that President-elect Marcos sought my help on.
Okay. Now, I'm curious, of course, during the campaign, you were also Sara Duterte Carpio's spokesperson. A post, I'm assuming you'd have to relinquish soon. Have you made recommendations? Who's replacing you with that responsibility?
It's been a distinct honor and pleasure to be the spokesperson of Vice President-elect Sara Duterte, whom I truly believe will excel as our vice president and will help unite our country together with President-elect Bongbong Marcos. Yes, I will have to move on from being her spokesperson once I formally take on the position of being tourism secretary. But at the moment, I have not presented any recommendations to her or discussed that matter with her.
Okay. Now, as the incoming tourism secretary, you did say that you wanted to focus on tourism. Now, in Liloan, for example, you introduced modern and digitalized systems, even electric transport for the residents, online medical consultation. What from Liloan can you take all over the country to improve tourism?
Well, both in Liloan and the entire province of Cebu, there is a wealth of talent from our local artists, artisans, and makers whose talents are evident in the products that they produce. And it would be wonderful to be able to shed light on these products and to give them a platform to be introduced nationally and globally. Not only that, I take with me the lessons of local governance, considering how important it is for the national government to have prior coordination with the local government in the tourist sites over which LGUs have jurisdiction, especially now where the Mandanas ruling calls for the implementation of the devolution mandate of the local government code, and which has been interpreted in an executive order by President Duterte. It is more, this even more imperative for the national government to coordinate with the local government in all aspects of the devolved functions, including tourism. And from our experience here in Cebu, it is only when you have very strong linkages between the local government units that you will be able to have a unified policy and an effective strategy to combat a very, very big challenge such as the pandemic and the recent calamities that we have suffered.
Okay, you talked about strong linkages. Pre-pandemic, the travel sector or tourism actually contributed 22.5% of the total economy in the Philippines. When the pandemic hit, it plunged by 80%. And tourism just gave a share of 4.8% to the country's GDP. How would you spur tourism to contribute more to the Philippine economy, especially that the incoming administration needs more revenues to fund its projects? How would you spur tourism, Mayor Frasco?
I think that having a very, very strong foundation for the industry is very important. And that means investing heavily in infrastructure as far as improving the connectivity and access to our tourist sites. So that means coordination closely with the relevant government agencies for the improvement of roads, bridges, access to seaports, airports, as well as modes of public transportation. Mm-mm. I think that the introduction of technology and innovation is also very important, as that is what the pandemic has taught us, that you can actually continue to market your products by way of digitalization, by way of mobile applications, through online platforms, notwithstanding the restrictions of a physical contact. So providing our lesser known tourist destinations with access through digitalization and through the introduction of online platforms that can shed light on them, I think, is also very important. President-elect Bongbong Marcos is also interested in improving the overall tourist experience, whether it's a domestic or foreign tourists, to make it convenient to come to the Philippines, to travel through the Philippines, and to stay in the Philippines. I think it's also very important to adopt a multidimensional approach to tourism, in that we capitalize not only on the beauty of our natural resources, but also on the wealth of talent of our people, as well as the products that they produce, including food, clothing, other items that could be marketable as well, both to local and foreign tourists. What the pandemic has also taught us, especially with the restrictions on travel from abroad, is that it's very important to capitalize on domestic tourism and to not be solely dependent on foreign tourism alone. In Cebu, immediately after some of the lockdowns were lifted, our hotels, our tourist destinations, even our local products were taken advantage, or rather were availed of by our local tourists. And we could see that there is now an ability by domestic tourists to also help sustain the tourism economy. Lastly, we've seen how negatively impacted tourism stakeholders and frontliners have been because of the pandemic and typhoons, calamities, and such. And so it's also very important to provide social protections for them to ensure that they feel the hand of government help them, especially in times of need.
Okay. Now, clearly you haven't seen the details yet in terms of what the DOT has spent on, but broad strokes, the 2022 budget was, I think, with the DOT is something like 3.5 billion, 3.52 billion, if I'm correct. Have you checked how much has already been disbursed, released? Mayor, would you have money this 2022? Would you have some flexibility?
At this juncture, we are still in the process of transition as far as the all the documentary matters are concerned. But I'm very hopeful that with President-elect Bongbong Marcos's declaration that he wishes for tourism to be one of the major economic pillars for the recovery of our country, that ways and means can be found to ensure that we will have the appropriate funding now and in the years to come to accomplish these goals for tourism.
Would you know already, Mayor, what programs would you keep from the existing DOT management? Like, for example, something simple, the theme, it's more fun in the Philippines. Are we going to see a change in that particular slogan or theme?
First of all, I would like to express my gratitude to the current leadership of the Department of Tourism, headed by Tourism Secretary Berna Romulo Puyat, as well as all of the personnel of the DOT that have helped our country sail through the difficulties of the pandemic. We're grateful for all of their hard work, and we recognize the proposals and plans for continuity. All of these plans and programs, including branding, will be presented to the president-elect, as he will be the one to set the vision for our country on all aspects, including tourism.
Okay. You talked about food tourism as being part of your agenda. Take us through that. What do you mean by food tourism? I remember Tourism Secretary Berna Puyat at the start of her term also mentioned something to that effect. But what is your vision when it comes to food tourism?
The experience of being in the Philippines and in our provinces, cities, and municipalities can be made more unique by having a multi-sensory approach to it, not only to please the eyes as far as the beauty of our natural resources are concerned, but also to please the other senses such as taste, smell, and all of this. No, we have a very unique identity as far as our food in every region. And I believe that we will be able to harness the tourism potential of this by including in our tourism platforms and our tourism packages, food tours throughout our regions to introduce local and foreign tourists to the distinct flavors of the many islands and regions of our country.
Okay, so food tours is one thing. Now, there are exciting prospects for Mindanao tourism. Let's talk about that. Are there specific areas and provinces that you would want to focus on?
Mindanao in general is a very, very beautiful part of our country that is endowed with natural beauty. However, due to challenges as far as peace and order is concerned in certain areas, the potential of the region perhaps has not been fully harnessed.
Yeah.
And so in general, as a region, I believe that it's important for us to extend economic opportunities to our brothers and sisters in Mindanao by taking a closer look at what each of the provinces, cities, and municipalities in Mindanao can offer, bearing in mind as well the accomplishments that the Duterte administration has had as far as establishing peace and order in the area. And Vice President-elect Sara Duterte herself has had many accomplishments in maintaining peace and order in the region. And with this as a base from which to improve on the attention that's been given to Mindanao, then I believe that the potential for development as far as tourism is quite big in that region.
Okay. Do you have specific areas? Because, of course, we know Davao. Davao is known for beautiful beaches, great food. There's also a lot of local products in Davao. Davao's been discovered as a great tourism destination. But are there other areas in Mindanao that you would like to focus on? And, you know, I interviewed recently the mayor, I believe, of Lanao del Norte, one of the towns there, and he would want to change the image of certain towns in Mindanao and make it more tourism friendly.
I think the challenge as far as certain areas in Mindanao is concerned is that certain quarters have written off the attractiveness of these areas because of other incidences in the past caused by certain elements of our society. And precisely, without me specifically naming one, because I don't want to leave out the others, it's should be a general effort to shed light on these lesser known areas that have not been given the opportunity to shine because of challenges to peace and order. I think that by taking a comprehensive approach to tourism, in that having an intergovernmental coordination as far as ensuring peace and order on one hand, while introducing economic prosperity in the other, on the other hand, can greatly help these certain areas in Mindanao that have not been given equal opportunity as far as tourism development is concerned. And for me, I would not be afraid to venture into the areas that have had challenges on peace and order, precisely because I believe that every city, every municipality, every island should be given equal opportunity for tourism development.
What What from Cebu, the lessons from Cebu, because Cebu, Cebu has everything, right? Cebu has nature, Cebu has beaches, very friendly locals, great products, creativity. Cebu's a manufacturing hub as well for many imported brands. What from Cebu would you like to bring to the whole Philippines? Would you want to replicate Cebu everywhere?
Apart from everything you have mentioned, which are all true, and I thank you, we also have a very strong governance model as far as tourism is concerned.
Okay. And you'd like to bring that in all LGUs, this strong governance model?
I believe that the tourism governance that has been strongly established in Cebu could serve as a good model to be applied all over the Philippines, as far as due respect and courtesy given to local government units for the tourist destinations within their jurisdiction, strong coordination as far as ensuring the sustainability of these tourist destinations, a very clear plan as far as the governmental support for tourism stakeholders and collaboration, coordination, and consensus building with tourism stakeholders has also proven to bode very well for the revival of the tourism industry in Cebu.
Yeah.
There's also this local program called Surisuroy Cebu that's been started by Governor Gwen Garcia that sheds light on lesser known tourist destinations in Cebu, and that has introduced both tourists to outside of those that may traditionally be part of the itinerary of people that visit Cebu. And I think proceeding from there and adopting the perspective that there is still so much in our country to be discovered and to be developed, then I think that can spread economic prosperity and spell the success of tourism as far as our islands are concerned. Mm-hmm. It's because of the unrelenting support for LGUs as well as our unity here in Cebu that has really helped us stand up to all of the difficulties that we've faced in the past years and months. And adopting this model in the Philippines can only help as far as the tourism industry is concerned.
And I remember Mayor Frasco sometime, I think, in 2002, former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo actually did the One Town, One Product. Because you did mention about discovering talents and products for each particular LGU. And that lasted, I think, for a few years. I'm not sure if it was carried over by other administrations. But are you seeing your own version of the One Town, One Product in partnership with the DTI, for example, to spur tourism?
I believe that towns and cities have more than one product
to showcase.
Be proud of.
Yeah.
Yes, to showcase. And casting a large net on the wealth of talents and products that each place can offer can help give more economic opportunities to more people. And so I think that we should not limit ourselves as far as featuring what are the highlights of a certain place, and rather cast as wide a net as we can as far as what we can highlight and develop in this or that particular area. The advantage that we have coming into this age of technology and innovation is that you're no longer limited to marketing your products in your place alone, but you have digital technology that can help marketability. And that is why I think it's very important to introduce digital innovation into the tourism industry by providing access to these products to tourists that can come to the Philippines. This is also one of the highlights of the administration of President-elect Bongbong Marcos that seeks to introduce digitalization to many aspects of governance in our country. That includes the tourism industry.
Okay, so Mayor Cristina, I mean, clearly you have extensive experience with the executive. What do you believe would your strength be, or how would you be described as a tourism secretary? Would you be good governance, or would you be a marketer as a tourism secretary? Anong nakikita nyo na talagang matatatakan kayo bilang tourism secretary, ma'am?
Well, first of all, I believe that I bring a local government perspective to tourism department. And being well-versed in the challenges that are faced from the grassroots and on the ground can help our Department of Tourism come up with sustainable, innovative, medium and long-term solutions to the challenges that our tourism frontliners, tourism stakeholders and partners continue to have as a result of the difficulties of the pandemic. I believe I also bring with me the experience of being local chief executive, whose main challenge is to face and try to solve crisis after crisis. We have just come out of a very difficult more than 2 years of struggle from the pandemic, and we ended our 2021 with a super typhoon. And that became a test of leadership for me as well as for other local chief executives. But with a firm focus on upholding the welfare of my people and ensuring that we have a firm foundation on infrastructure, social protections, programs that can shield the economic impact of all of these crises, then these experiences that I have had as a mayor, I would like to believe can help in the recovery of the tourism industry as a whole.
Okay.
And as I mentioned,
okay, just two more questions, Mayor Frasco. In terms of being tourism secretary, would you say that the environment will take top priority in your agenda? There are several islands in the Philippines and several destinations we know that face challenges when it comes to protecting the environment. Just recently, the DENR canceled the ECC of a reclamation project in Coron. And we know how beautiful Palawan is, the last frontier. And you have places like Coron where at one point it had challenges with trash, and now there's a reclamation project. And it's not alone. There are many other islands that face several other challenges as well. Paano po si Tourism Secretary Frasco with these issues?
Environmental sustainability is of utmost importance, because if we do not ensure the sustainability of our tourist destinations, then not only will this make the tourist destinations in danger of being less beautiful, attractive, and less sustainable, but also it would ultimately be a deficit for our country, in that we would lose the commercial viability of these tourist sites. It's only by being very conscious of preserving the viability of these sites that we can ensure that tourism remains sustainable. But at the same time, we also have to be able to strike a balance between sustainability and development. And I don't think that these two things have to clash with each other, or nor are they mutually exclusive. They can go hand in hand as long as we have very strong public-private partnerships in which the standards for sustainability are made clear, while still trying to also accomplish commercial viability as far as the sites are concerned. I think that both things have to clash, and I think that they can go hand in hand with proper coordination and collaboration.
Okay, like for example, the Masungi Geo Reserve is one such site that's facing some that's facing challenges. Although the DENR did suspend the quarrying permits of, I think, three companies, you have NGOs in Masungi requesting that the permits be cancelled completely. Where would Tourism Secretary Frasco stand on something as controversial as, let's say, mining, quarrying near tourism destinations?
Well, first of all, I believe that the primary jurisdiction on these issues rests with the Department of Environment and Natural Resources, as well as the Mining and Geosciences Bureau. And their recommendations would first have to take precedence over any other opinion. I think it is important to yield to expert opinion as far as the viability of these projects are concerned. Secondly, the moment that these types of activities would have a potential danger or negative impact on the viability of a tourist destination, then that is where the Department of Tourism should take a more active role. And so it is with intergovernmental relations and coordination that I think we would be able to find a way forward. So it's important to listen to expert opinion and at the same time to continue collaborations with fellow government agencies as well as the private sector.
Okay, my last question in terms of foreign tourists. We know that the Philippines could have more foreign tourists compared to our ASEAN neighbors, for example, have pre-pandemic have had astounding numbers. Would this be part of your either first 100 days or would this be in your medium-term plan? We've had, I think, South Koreans as our biggest foreign tourists in terms of Asia coming to the Philippines. Would this be part of your program, Secretary? Or will you be focusing mostly on domestic tourism first?
I think that the effort should be comprehensive to include both domestic tourism and foreign tourism, especially now with the further relaxation of the requirements for entry into the Philippines. We can anticipate the influx of foreign tourists from the usual countries that visit our country. However, I think it's also important to take a look at the other markets that have not necessarily been fully harnessed as far as bringing them into the Philippines.
Yeah.
And indeed, it's important to look at our neighbors and their successes as far as tourism is concerned, so that we can also learn from these successful tourism models and try to adopt what we can that is practical to our country. Lastly, I having been mayor for nearly 6 years, I know by now that there is really not the you cannot move mountains in 100 days.
Yeah, true.
But you
true.
Set a clear policy as far as where you want to go in the short term, in the mid term, and in the long term. And the approach that I intend to take is one not only of theoretical ideas, but rather of practical application to be able to temper our goals yeah. with the realities that are on the ground
yeah.
and really to roll up our sleeves and to try to improve as much as we can on the infrastructure that mm-hmm. is in our country to be able to improve the tourist experience overall and in general. It's important to understand as well that repeat tourists is also very important.
Very true.
To be able to get them to come to our country, to stay in our country, and to come back.
Yeah.
It's good to have a strong brand, but at the same time, you also have to be very conscious to have a strong product. And you can only have that if you firm up the foundation of your product. And that's where, as I already mentioned, investment in infrastructure, innovation, yeah. sustainability, strong inter and intra-governmental linkages can come in, as well as collaboration with the private sector and tourism stakeholders.
Okay, just very quickly, do you believe you'll be asking for incentives for the tourism sector with the incoming administration? I mean, in the first few months of President-elect Bongbong Marcos, there is a challenge, of course, they need revenue generation. But do you think incentives for the tourism sector is possible?
Well, our president-elect would have to also examine closely the capabilities of our country fiscal-wise,
yeah.
as far as budget is concerned. But at the same time, we should not limit ourselves to this year alone, as there are five years plus, that are available to this administration as far as crafting a budget that can include incentives and stimulus packages for the tourism industry. Overall, I believe that our tourism stakeholders and our fellow Filipinos can take comfort in the fact that President-elect Bongbong Marcos sees tourism as a very strong economic driver.
Yeah.
And with that, we can be assured of strong national government support, not only for the Department of Tourism itself, but more importantly, for our local government units and our constituents all over the Philippines.
All right. Well, on that note, incoming Tourism Secretary Cristina Frasco, congratulations to you and we wish you the best. Good luck.
Daghang salamat. Thank you, Karen.